happens, you will not go back. Don't be a theologian. There are too many of them. Yahweh, Yahweh. The second thing that makes for spiritual power is the move of the Spirit. See, this is why power is scarce. I'm telling you, because few people experience these things. And those who don't experience it come out to argue. And they keep comparing notes. Notes don't cast out demons. I was sharing humorously in Kaduna. You see a man who have subdued the darkness of his generation talking. And then somebody who has no encounter, who has not touched reality, will come and perch on the comment box. And he's talking what he doesn't know. Talking what they don't know. So it's on comment. Your platform is on comment box. And then he perches there. Like a gazelle. Bringing scriptures from left to right. Throwing them like arrows. How about this scripture? You know all this scripture. How come you're on the comment box? Before you know, some of them will take laptop and type 4 pages. Bah, 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 bah. No wonder you have time. They will type 4 pages. They want people to read. After typing for 2 hours, it's only one person that will read it. And then you'll see one like. The like will hang like this. And then he will say, yeah, he has told them the truth. Who? You don't know that even to hear you is a commandment in the spirit. This is my beloved son, in whom I'm here, well pleased. Hear ye him. Who told you they will hear you? I told my friends humorously, I don't fight for platforms and pulpits. Because even if they take you to Shiloh and you preach, nobody will remember you came. Unless there is power. There's a commandment in the spirit that say, hear ye him. If that commandment has not gone forth, if you like, go to TBN. They will forget that you ever came. You will finish preaching and come down. Even the people in the studio will say, yeah, how are you? You'll not say, well, you the one preaching now. Well done, well done. Don't join the bandwagon. Labor in the spirit. It's an honorable thing. The Bible said the glory of the Lord is to conceal a matter. He said, but the honor of kings is to search out the matter. Said the Christians in Berea were more noble than those in Thessalonica, because when they heard the word, they went to search to see if the thing said were so. Some people tell you, you don't need encounter, just meditate. You are joking. Those who have it know. They can tell you every spot that there was a shift in their life, because it is never by coincidence. It's definite and deliberate. They will tell you when the slain anointing came on them. They will tell you when the anointing to pack crowds and overflow came on them. They will tell you when the anointing to heal the sick. It is definite. It's not coincidental. The second thing that makes for the power of God is the move of the Spirit. Luke 1:35, it said, and the Holy Ghost shall come upon you, and the power of the highest shall overshadow you, and that thing that will be formed in you shall be called the Son of the Highest. The Holy Ghost shall come. Now, I was sharing with Dunsin 2 days ago, and he said, what struck him about the scripture? He said, Mary asked, how shall these things be, seeing that I know not a man? So there is a kind of power that comes upon you, that everything that should be a disadvantage becomes the access point for manifestation. The impossible part of it is what makes the testimony beautiful. How shall these things be, seeing that I know not a man? And he said, the Holy Ghost shall come upon you. The power of the highest shall overshadow you. If there is no move of the Spirit in your life, there's no power. Everybody that commands authority in the kingdom is a man flooded with the move of the Spirit. This is not psychology. This is not emotional. It's a definite reality. The move of the Spirit in their soul is strong. And the move of the Spirit is not a feeling. Yes, yes. Sir, it's not a feeling. It's not a feeling. He said, not many days from now, the Holy Ghost, the same Holy Spirit, you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you. And then somebody say, I have the Holy Ghost, so I have power. Acts chapter 4 verse 29. When they were flogged, beaten and threatened, they went back to their own company. And as they prayed, the place where they were was shaking. And they were filled with the Spirit again. And verse 33, with great power. With great power. It was the move of the Spirit that made for power. There are many people that are dry. The Holy Ghost don't move in their lives. They come on the altar and they know the songs to sing to spur the people. I know my songs. If I begin to sing them, I will jack up like a bird. I deliberately didn't sing them because it's not about a song. I want to show you something that you will deliberately practice, and then you will touch a sick person. He will be healed. Yes. It's not psychology. Yes, yes, yes. You will speak over something. It will happen. It's not psychology. Because there will be authority on your lips. And the Holy Ghost filled them afresh. And with great power gave testimony to the apostles of the resurrection. And great grace was upon them all. It was the move of the Spirit that necessitated it. But how do you know the move of the Spirit is in your life? There is a definite indicator for the move of the Spirit. The indicator that the move of the Spirit is in a man's life is not that he prays loud. It's not that when he carries the microphone, he's thundering like thunder. No. The indicator that the move of the Spirit is strong upon a man's life is not that he's charismatic. It is an organic thing. A man that God is moving upon, sustain one thing, is called hunger. There is hunger for the presence of God. The day the hunger for the presence begins to die, the move of the Spirit is beginning to wane. And the things you could command before, you will be shocked. You will try it will not happen. For most of us who are preachers, we are at a most risky place on this subject. Because you keep dispensing. You keep dispensing. I told my brother, I'm not supposed to be here. I came here on the basis of relationship. Up until yesterday, I was lying down helpless. I say, Lord, Lord, I'm strengthened with might by your Spirit in the inner man. I should be recovering. I can't even feel myself. But there is a truth I need to release into your hands. And that's why I came. It's a move. If the move of the Spirit is upon a man, it's not a feeling. It is unending passion for the presence. I was talking with a brother and he told me something. He said, the best gift of the Spirit and the first gift of the Spirit is not one of the 9 gifts that the world have taught. He said, the Bible said in 1 Peter 2 verse 2, as newborn babes desire the sincere milk. The word there is desire. The ability to continually hunger for God and for his things. That's the best gift a Spirit can give to you. If a man constantly desires God, he doesn't even need to go around preaching. He can kneel in his room and he can provoke revival over eternity because he's talking. Did you not read? When Jesus came, who provoked the revival? It was Simeon and Anna. They were not part of the preachers of their generation. They were just in the synagogue praying. And the moment they brought Jesus to the temple, the Bible says Simeon moved by the Spirit. The Holy Ghost himself went to meet him. He said, this thing you have interceded for has come. So you come and announce it. The guy was not a preacher. Nobody knew him. But he could not leave the presence of God. The men that shake territories are not necessarily the ones that travel about. The men that shake territories are the men that will never back off from the presence. There is something that keeps them there. In John chapter 2 verse 17, he said, the zeal of my Father's house. The zeal. It's not zeal for preaching. It's not zeal for miracle. He said, the zeal of my Father's house has consumed me. Jesus will leave a crusade and go to the mountain. and he will be there from night till morning. How come he's never tired? There was an energy on his inside that pulls him to God perpetually. And David knew it firsthand. He knew it. He said, as the deer panted, as the deer panted, as the deer panted. You look at David, he fought 44 battles. He won. You think it's about bows and arrows. He has nothing to do. He said, as the deer panted after the Lord, so my soul longed after thee in a dry and in a thirsty land where no waters is. At some point he said, even while I am on my bed, thy thoughts and thy words are the meditations of my heart. That's a warrior. So the power that David used to fight war was not skill, it was hunger. When God wanted to punish David, he said, you can do anything to me, but take not thy spirit from within me. I can afford to lose the throne. I can afford to lose everything, but your presence never, never, never. And so long as David sought after the Lord, the hand of God was perpetually upon him. Every time a man begins to seek the presence of God, he begins to unlock the heavens. He begins to unlock the heaven. This is the secret of Elijah. Many people thought Elijah was just powerful because he was a man of faith. Elijah was more a man of intimacy than a man of faith. Because everything you see Elijah does, he does it from the place of intimacy. He told the king, put your house together. There will be an abundance of rain. And then you will think he declares and he goes to eat. And he went to the mountain and knelt down 7 times. Mana, kada, mana, kada. Until he said, go and check. Go and check. So he knew to unlock the heavens, you do it on your knee. And as he was groaning there, at the 7th time, the servant came and said, I saw something that looked like the feast of a man. So Elijah created that feast in the cloud. The feast was nowhere. He created it because he knows the secret of power. When Jesus was about to begin ministry, it was the season of temptation for him. The Bible said the Spirit led him into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. But when Jesus went there, he changed his season. He was engaging God, because before the devil came, he went 40 days and 40 nights in prayer and fasting. When the devil came, that was a walkover. What Jesus did on that mountain that was supposed to be a season of temptation became a season of announcing and affecting his word. But how did he do it? By engaging God, by pressing into God. And as he was groaning there, the writings of the Spirit began to change. We say, come to the mountain to be tempted. But because of what you are doing now, it will no longer be temptation, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet. The land of Zebulun, the land of Naphtali, by the way of the sea beyond Jordan, Galilee of the Gentile, the people that sat in darkness have seen a great light. And he stepped down from the mountain, and his fame went abroad. The power to cause change is resident upon hunger. How much of it do you carry? How much of it? There are many Christians that are dry. Even when they are in church, they are already tired. 1 hour in church, they are frustrated. And then they are sleeping, they think they are tired. They are not. There is no capacity for the move of God. So the moment they step out, they were dozing in church. But as they enter the road immediately, they become agile. Because the God of this world still has a place in their heart. So no matter how tired they were in church, when they step out and they begin to interact with the one they have intimacy with on the internet, on the television, with their friends, they come alive. Hunger for the presence of God. These are ancient realities, but they are no longer taught. I read the story of Brother Lawrence, and God told him that a servant in the kingdom of God is more important than a general. Because a servant is always there to attend to his voice. Some generals are giving away to commanding. So they are too used to the battlefield that they forget the sounds of Zion. They never return. They never return. They are obsessed with commanding the army. And they forget. They forget. So in Exodus 28 verse 1 and 2, he said to anoint Aaron and his son to minister unto me in the priest office. So before legislation, there is intimacy. If you can't minister to him, you have no power to legislate over your territory. The reason we are handicapped is because hunger for God has diminished. Many things have truncated it. It is dwarfed. There are no men anymore that yearns after God. People are asking for the mantle of Babalola. Did you know that every 3 hours they pray in tongues for 1 hour in Babalola's house for close to 40 years? Did you know that during the early part of the year, for the first 4 months, the man goes to the mountain to spend 40 days in prayer? Are you aware of the labors of Babalola in the spirit? Do you have his hunger? If that unction rests upon you, do you have the capacity to accommodate it? I was standing on the altar, an unction came upon me, I almost collapsed. That was when I knew that instead of praying for dimension, we need to pray for capacity. Because what is coming, it can't rest on men. They are too shallow. There's no depth, there's no capacity for the Holy Ghost to rest upon. We receive impartations, they don't last for 2 weeks. Because we don't have the capacity to nurture the concentrate consecration for that impartation. You go to receive an impartation from a man that spent the first 6 hours of his day in prayer. Do you know the level of appetite that impartation rests on? And then your own appetite is 5 minutes. And then how can you accommodate that impartation? When the spirit comes, it will lift. That's why all the big men have imparted us. Yet there's no manifestation. Because appetite is not there. Appetite. It is the volume of your appetite that determines the degree of your manifestation. When you have no appetite for a spirit, you can't host the dimensions of that spirit. You may hear things and desire it. It will end in the realm of desire until hunger drives you there. And when you come before that spirit, he will allow you for a long time because he wants to enlarge your appetite. You will come, you will pray for 5 minutes, you will go. He won't say anything. You will increase it to 3 minutes, to 3 hours. Did you not read about the Azusa Street Revival? They prayed in tongues for 7 hours for 8 months, and he told them to increase it to 9 hours. What is coming? The urgency of the spirit. Their capacity have not yet been enlarged, and he needed to work on it. So they increased. And when they began to enlarge their appetite, suddenly the move of the spirit came. That's why I say, tarry in Jerusalem until you are endued. He didn't say tarry for 10 days. He didn't say tarry for 20 days. Tarry until you are endued. When you come to that gauge of the spirit where you can accommodate it, then the wind of the spirit will move. Many people have no appetite for God. They have appetite for many things. The guy can sit and watch 4 matches. The guy can sit and watch 3 seasonal movies in 3 weeks. But when you say come to God's presence, suddenly he begins to dwindle. He begins to dwindle. He begins to drown. But he said, they that journey to the deep, they are the ones that qualify to see the wonders of God. You have not journeyed enough. Your appetite is too shallow. The measure that you are looking for, it takes appetite to accommodate it. How much of God can you accommodate? This is what we do when we besiege him. Because when you want to increase hunger, you dump yourself on God. And as you keep pressing, you may not see light in the sky. You may not see an angel walk into your room. You may not hear a voice saying, Nathaniel, my son, you are a prophet. You may not hear that. But after 40 days, you will discover that what you were doing for 1 hour that looked like Mount Sinai, suddenly 12 hours, that's when you are beginning to charge. At that point, you can begin to interact in the heavens. And when the spirit comes down, he will come down in measures unquantified. Our generation lacks hunger. We only desire manifestation, but we don't desire the presence. This is why we cannot command power. It's beyond suit. It's beyond utterance. I come to certain places, and then the anointing for preaching comes on me, and I begin to touch my vocabularies, and people are shouting everywhere. One day I stop. I say, what did I say? Sir, what did I say? I say, wait. Off the keyboard. What did I say? I went back and told God, help me. So sometimes I come to a place, I bombard them with instructions upon instruction. So if they don't remember anything, when they go home, they will remember hunger. They will remember encounter. If that's all they remember, any way they route it, perfect. Yahweh. In Songs of Solomon chapter 1 from verse 1 to 3, he said, kiss me with the kisses of thy mouth. He said, thy love is better than wine. Thy love is better than wine. The guy knew the obsession of his generation. What intoxicated his generation was wine. But he had found another appetite. He said, thy love is better than wine. He said, my king has invited me to his bedchamber. He said, we will not remember the testimony of the wine. He has found another obsession. And for that one, he can be there for many days. And the more he stays with him, the more he comes alive. The more he comes alive. The more he comes. Because the appetite is unending. You can't quench it. People love men, but they don't love God. They love the things of God, but they don't love God. God told me something. He said, our generation is still struggling with the lowest realm of power. The ability to command things. The ability to command things. And then when we command things, we are happy. He said, but there are realms of power. He said, the highest realm of power is stamina in my presence. That's why the 20 and 4 elders are the highest ranking in Zion. They have the ability to stay in the presence. The Bible said the four beasts, day and night, forever and ever, forever and ever, they stand in the presence of God. What are they doing? Holy, 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 holy is the Lamb. Holy, forever and ever, day and night. They don't need to manifest. But when you read the scripture, you will discover that this being walk at the frequency of God. When Ezekiel saw the throne of God, he said, wherever God went, the four living creatures went at the same speed. They don't need to manifest anymore because they have built capacity to stand in God's presence. They function exactly like God. They move like the lightning and the thunder. Pew! When God moves, they have moved. When the wheels move, they have moved. You can't see God and not see them. Every time you see them moving, know that's the frequency of God. And every time you see God moving, know that is their frequency. How did they become so mighty? Those ones don't need to do any stunt. When they appear, their similitude is like that of Yahweh himself. Because they have built power to stand in God's presence. The strongest of us is not the one that works the greatest miracle. Is the one that can stand in the presence. The man with unending hunger for the presence. The horn of that one is like the government of heaven. It's like the deer. When you want to see the power of a deer, you check his horns. When a deer grows into maturity, the horn splits into seven. That's the seven government of heaven. It is reflective of authority, not just on earth, but in the spirit. A man can stand. And it's no longer commanding just demons. It's no longer commanding healing. But when he speaks, he resonates in Zion. The Bible said Joshua told the sun to stand upon the mountains of Ajalon. And the moon upon the valley of Gibeon. He said the sun did not make haste to go down. And he said something that I cannot use any theology to explain. He said there have never been a day like that. And never will there be. He said in the day that God hearkened to the voice of a man. These are men that have power in the courts of heaven. The Bible spoke concerning Abraham. He said, will I do a thing without telling my servant Abraham? That's God talking. They perfected the judgment of Sodom and Gomorrah from the heights of heaven, and God came down with two angels to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. Abraham had enough stature, and he said, far be it from you that the just God will destroy the righteous and the unrighteous. What if you find 50 men? Do you mean you can change on earth things that were concluded in heaven? If you live in heaven, yes, you can. And God said, if I find 50 righteous men, I will not destroy the land. And he was going to say, if I found favor with you, what if you find 40 righteous men? So if Abraham had not stopped, Abraham would have changed something that the court of heaven have concluded. That's the level of power a man that stands in the presence commands. No wonder Elijah said, before God whom I stand, there shall be no rain nor dew. The power to stop heaven, it is for men that stands in the presence. Our generation don't know the presence. We know scriptures. We know messages. We know strategies and gimmicks. But we have no power. We have no power because there are no men that can stand in the presence. We come from meetings like this and all we are looking for is impartation. No. when you come for meetings like this, live with instructions. Tell yourself, I'm tired of the status quo. Apostle A imparted me. Apostle B imparted me. Apostle C imparted me. I appreciate this impartation, but I want to become. What is it that this man saw? How did they enter into this reality? I want it. And if it takes you to stay with God for 8 months, it's worth it. It's worth it. Because that 8 months will make your life count in the next 40 years. If you don't wait, you will continue with mediocrity until when you are 90 years. It will look as if you are there, but you are not there. They looked at you, they say you are an apostle. They honored you, but when they came close, there was nothing. They say you are a revivalist. You look like it, but when they came close, there was nothing. They say you have healing mantle. When they came close, there was nothing. Because every time they confronted you one-on-one, there was no reality to show. Tell yourself, I refuse mediocrity. There is something I must step into. I know this reality is bigger than impartation. There is an instruction in the spirit that I must commit myself to for this thing to work out through me. I don't want trial and error. I went for a meeting 1 month ago. Something happened. And then nothing happened again until after 1 month. And every time you give testimony, 4 years ago, 5 years ago, I don't want anything ago. I want everything now. Because his name is called, I am that I am. Every time I want God to manifest. So what must I do? Is to tarry. That's true power. If you want to cause changes, this is the key. It's bigger than doctrine. I tell you, it is bigger than doctrine. These are the secrets that changes things in the natural realm. Force yourself to stay there until the chambers of your spirit begin to open up. I was there for 3 hours, nothing happened. I will increase it to 4 hours. I stayed for 4 hours for 1 month, nothing happened. I won't go out when nothing has happened. I will move it to 5 hours. I was there for 6 hours, nothing happened. I will move it to 7 hours. By all means, stay until the move of the spirit begins. When it begins, even yourself will know that something has changed. You will no longer try to cajole people. At any time, you can stop and say, let this happen. You have it. You have it. God told me the mystery of mantles. He said the way mantles are created in the spirit is to download a dimension. He said when you download a dimension, that dimension is handed to you as a mantle. You can hand it over to another generation. And there were certain men that it took 10 years for a dimension to download in their lives. There were certain men that it took 5 years. There were certain men that it took months. For months, the Holy Ghost bound them. Don't go out in the daytime. Don't sleep at night. And every night they stand up. When they are tired and they want to sleep, that hand will come and tap them. Wake up. And every night they stand. And after 6 months, the download is complete. And God says, go out. And then the guy comes out and he becomes like a cherubim among men. He has downloaded something from Zion. He took six months of sleepless night, but he waited. Never truncate what God began in your life because you lose capacity to stand in the presence. Yahweh, Yahweh. Yahweh, Yahweh. We're out of time. We're out of time. The third thing I wanted to share